Aditi and Shreya, who recently got through the top development consulting firm DALBERG, and they're here to share with us their experience and the secrets of their success. So my first question to you, I'm sure a lot of people have asked you the same before, was this your dream job, and if yes, then why?
This was my dream job. I was looking at various development consulting firms, and I had like this list of firms, and like DALBERG was on top, but given the history in our college, like I was not too sure about whether or not DALBERG would work out. So I also had some other development consulting firms that I wanted to opt for, but luckily this worked out. So
not at all for me. I knew that I liked consulting and it interested me, but this largely wasn't my dream job because I didn't think I had a kind of resume that reflected my interest in development. So if you look at Unnati's resume, she's done like crazy internships with like the Hillary Clinton Health Foundation and so on. And there's like an active sort of message coming from her resume. It's something I'm really passionate about. For me, I just kind of did internships at places that I found interesting, so there wasn't really a large team. So I thought like, okay, I'll apply for this because this is a lovely firm and they do such good work, but I don't think I'm gonna get it. So it didn't figure on my dream job list simply because I didn't think that I would ever get selected.
So a lot of us have heard about management consultancies in general, but when it comes to development consultancy, not everybody is aware as to, you know, what kind of work you've got to do once you make it to one. So could you throw some light on the kind of work that a development consultancy firm does?
Development consultant works with various organizations, largely in developing nations. So we're talking about African nations, India, probably Latin American nations. They work with organizations ranging from your non-governmental organizations to the government, and they largely work out of the social sector. So where public health is concerned, public education, infrastructure, and the end aim is all about maximizing social impact.
So just to build on that also, so your landscape where you work is more or less a developing world. But it can also be like they also work in countries like the United States or the United Kingdom,
right?
Because that is where your donors are. Mm-hmm. So there are various organizations in the sector that range from, as she said, like the non-governmental organizations, the governments. It could also be your donor firms or your donor, your basically who your clients are, and even say some social entrepreneurship startups or who want to scale up. So your clients can range from very huge.
So you just mentioned certain points about the interview. So one thing that haunts a lot of applicants is whether the selection procedure is going to be very daunting. So could you just run us through the selection procedure in terms of the kind of rounds that you had to face and the different areas that they're testing you on?
So for us in our college, what they did was they had a shortlist of candidates that would be appearing for their online Skype interview, which was the first round, I think. So just like a caution that shortlist is not... like, we weren't really sure of the criteria they had for that particular shortlist. In a lot of cases, it seemed sort of arbitrary, although I'm sure that there was logic at the end of the company.
And it reinforced the thing that like having a background in development is absolutely not, because we know a bunch of people who have done such great internships with like NTI, and Nabad and stuff like that, we didn't get through.
Apart from that, we had the online Skype interview where they were judging first your quantitative skills, like, or your aptitude. So we had two numerical questions. And there was another part of that interview where they were understanding your personality and also asking you why you're interested in DALBERG and why you're interested in the sector. And post that, they shortlisted about 8 people from our college for the personal interview rounds. So
yes.
Some of us had it only via Skype, like Shreya had it in Bombay. So her first few rounds were on Skype, and then I think she went to the office.
Yeah.
For us, a couple of us went to the Delhi office and we had about 5 rounds, which were about an hour.
5 rounds? So each round was eliminative. So Unnati, me and one other person had 5 rounds in total. But after each round, they take stock and decide whether you progress to the next round.
Yeah. So in the personal rounds, they ask you sort of, it's a mix of both your HR questions
and
as well as your interviews
format.
Yeah. it's yeah, like here you have a case interview, you have a guesstimate, and you also have your HR questions, if that's okay.
So taking the conversation forward from here on, you just talked about case interviews. So could you elaborate a bit more on the kind of cases that were presented before you and how you went about, you know, answering them or sort of doing that?
Yeah, sure. So the cases that you answer are firstly largely derivative from their website. So if you go there, DALBERG has a lot of ongoing projects all across the globe. So in many instances, you will be interviewing with associates who have worked on the field on those very projects. So they will ask you, they will take that case and whatever they have done for like a year or 2 years and ask you questions about that. What I found, or for me at least, in my fifth round, I interviewed with a partner who picked a case based on what he was reading off my resume. So I had authored a policy paper with someone and was on labor law reforms, and he had done a project on youth unemployment in Kashmir. So he put those two things together and gave me a case. So a lot of times interviewers come in with a case and they want to ask you, they're going to ask you about the market size for blah blah blah. But other times they just look at and try to guess what kind of person you are maybe, and go for a case that comes on the top of their head. But for sure, I would recommend going through all the ongoing projects on the DALBERG website and familiarizing yourself thoroughly with each and every detail on your resume, because everything is up for grabs.
Yeah, I would surely bank on everything that she said. To add to that, I think an interesting pattern that I observed from my interviews was that they were trying to test my ability to deal with the cases that spanned across different clients that they deal with. So we had everything from a company to a donor firm to an NGO to like to the government. And also, like she said, she was asked a case from her CV, and something similar happened with me. In fact, in my final round, I had worked in political strategy before, and one of the people in my team was the professor of the partner at Harvard. So he asked me three cases from that CV and one sort of stem from another, and it was almost an hour and a half long, and it was just like constant.
And it was a crazy case. It was if Rahul Gandhi had to win the 2019 elections, how would you go about campaigning?
And at the end of it, he was like, okay, then. And
so like it goes development cases for which there aren't many like resources per se online as compared to the like your run of the mill management business cases. Then you have your guesstimates, which will again have a sort of development spin on them. So like estimate the number of women who don't have access to internet or something like that. You're gonna have your HR questions, which are by DALBERG, by development.
Tell me about yourself, like the first thing you start off with.
Nothing too hard in that. And then you have like these crazy questions which you do not see coming at all. What was it for you? What was your
question? So for me, they asked, say you're given a situation that you know you enter, there are various people sitting on a table, right? Like you have NGOs, you have researchers, you have organizations who've been working at the grassroots for years. So they have a lot of experience to them, and you're a consultant and you're known for the trait of not having enough knowledge. And this is like an ethical question that they're asking you. So how do you tackle this dilemma? Like how do you approach a client that is very wary of you and averse to your intrusion into their space? And he asked me to answer that. So like these are the kind of questions that you don't see coming. And I think it is also because of their nature that they want to test you around these, because they want to know how you did respond to certain things.
Correct, yeah.
Situational questions.
They're not necessarily looking for an answer or a right answer. For me, the question was, how would you evacuate the entire city of Mumbai in 5 hours? And I was just, and then the partner was like, do you want me to give you some advice? And I said, please. And he said, no one has ever been able to solve this problem. It is deeply complex. I said, thank you. That was so helpful. No, but again, and I think this is also a lesson on what they're looking for, is that they're, one, looking for you to keep calm, especially in unconventional questions like this. Secondly, they're just looking for structured thinking, and that will be across cases, guesstimates, the way you answer your HR question. Like, you're giving 3 points, are you just kind of meandering and giving one long speech, right? They're looking for structure everywhere, including in these crazy questions.
So this conversation definitely gives us a lot of insight, and I'm sure it's going to be very helpful for a lot of people. So apart from the questions that we've covered, is there any sort of general advice that you would want to give to your juniors? Anything in general?
I would recommend that you just start reading up on it in general. Read books like, say, Poor Economics, More Than Good Intentions. If you're really keen on it, learn to differentiate and decide whether or not you want to work in this sector. And there are various routes of going about it. You can also enter consulting or enter banking, and then enter this either from a development consulting domain or an impact investment domain. So for me, especially, this was my long-term goal. It wasn't like I had closed in entirely on other consulting firms. I thought that maybe I could work for 2 years and then enter this sector. But at the same time, I knew that because this is a goal I want to achieve, I was also going to apply to various other firms in the sector, and there are plenty. So that is something you should, I mean, if you're inclined towards the sector and know for sure that you want to enter this field, then a lot of material is out there, and you don't necessarily have to read one of the, you know, your regular management consulting books to be able to get it. I don't even know how much my case prep even helped me, because I don't remember like taking anything out of it. It was just at the moment what was coming to my mind and what I was giving for.
Yeah, about the same. I think what I did get out of case prep was that structured thinking, they do value your mutually exclusive and collectively exhaustive sort of method of breaking down something. Even if it's a very qualitative case, they want to see that kind of structure on your sheet. And otherwise, yeah, nothing more. Just like, yeah, read up the DALBERG projects, read up everything about that. Like Unnati said, read something extra about the field, keep updated about the trends, and just know that they want you to succeed. So like, you should go in there feeling just like that this is going to be fun. You're in an interview with someone who's done amazing things, who's been in fields like Kenya or South Africa and stuff, so it's a brilliant.
Yeah, I think one of an extra suggestion would be read up about the people at the firm.
Yeah.
Like LinkedIn is a very useful resource. So in my first interview, the lady who interviewed me, I had seen her profile on LinkedIn, so I knew what projects she'd worked on.
Yeah.
And she sort of gave me a project from there, and so that gave us something to talk about. So. Yeah, so another recommendation that would come from this would be that when you're asked your questions around HR, make sure you're not giving something that's really arbitrary. Like, it should always add direction to your interview. He should, because, you know, from what I know about the interview process, they write your answers down, and they should be able to link everything through and conclude that you're a suitable candidate. And so I think that would, if you have the time to think about your HR questions, which you should, you should be able to make sure that your answers are in line with what you want, with the image that you want to convey to them.
So thank you, Shreya and Unnati, for your time. And guys, stay tuned for more videos.
Lions roaring in the morning sun. Such a